Now, ladies and gentlemen, something new this year, we're having a CEO forum. During this forum, we'll be able to hear from the leaders in the industry, speak about their challenges and opportunities that they face in the palm oil industry. And this special forum will be chaired, moderated by none other than Yang Berbahagia Tan Sri Dato' Dr. Yusuf Basirong, the CEO of Malaysian Palm Oil Council. I'd like to invite him to take his place on the stage. Allow me to welcome the other distinguished panel members, starting with Yang Berbahagia Tan Sri Lee Oi Hian, the CEO of Kuala Lumpur Kepong Berhad. Yang Berbahagia Dato' Lee Yao Chor, CEO of IOI Plantations, as well as the chairman of MPOC. Yang Berbahagia Dato' Frankie Anthony Das, Managing Director of Saim Dabi Plantations. And Supermaniam R. Ramasamy, President of Global Head of Plantation Olam. Now, ladies and gentlemen, each of these distinguished speakers will have 5 minutes to share their points of view and their comments, their opinions regarding the challenges and opportunities they face in the palm oil industry. Allow me to quickly read through the bio data of each of our distinguished speakers. First of all, Tan Sri Lee Oi Hian, Chief Executive Officer of Kuala Lumpur Kepong Berhad since 2001, graduated from the University of Malaya in Agricultural Science in 1974, followed by an MBA from Harvard Business School in 1977. The KLK Group is a plantations-based group with a planted area about 220,000 hectares, mainly of oil palm, located in Malaysia, Indonesia, and Liberia. KLK also has integrated into oleochemicals downstream manufacturing. Tan Sri Lee has served in various positions in the plantation industry, namely in the Malaysian Palm Oil Council, the Malaysian Estate Owners Association, the Malaysian Oil Palm Growers Council, the Malaysian Palm Oil Board, and the Malaysian Cocoa Board. Tan Sri Lee was conferred the Darjah Seri Paduka Mahkota Perak, or SPMP, in 2006 by the Sultan of Perak, and in June 2010, he was conferred the Tan Sri Award by the Yang di-Pertuan Agong. Can we give a round of applause to our first panelist, Tan Sri Lee Oi Hian? Next, we have Dato' Lee Yao Chor, who is presently the CEO of IOI Corporation Berhad, a Malaysia-based transnational corporation. He has been on the board of directors of IOI Corporation Berhad and IOI Properties Berhad since 96, and a board of directors of IOI Properties Group Berhad since 2013. Dato' Lee is a barrister from Gray's Inn, London, and holds an LLB in honours from King's College, London in 1988, and a postgraduate diploma in finance and accounting from the London School of Economics in 1990. Prior to joining IOI Group as a general manager in 94, he served in various capacities in the Malaysian Attorney General's Chambers and the Malaysian Judiciary Service for about 4 years. His last posting was as a magistrate in Kuala Lumpur. Dato' Lee was appointed as a director of Bank Negara Malaysia in February 2015. Dato' Lee has been the chairman of Malaysian Palm Oil Council since 2009 and has also been serving as a council member in the Malaysian Palm Oil Association since its formation in 2002. He was formerly a board member of the Malaysian Green Technology Corporation and the Secretary General of the Malaysian Real Estate Housing Developers Association. Please give me a round of applause for Dato' Lee Yao Chor. Next, we have Dato' Frankie Anthony Das, the Managing Director from Saim Dabi Plantations. Dato' Frankie, I've heard applause twice now, so you obviously have a good fan base out here. Dato' Frankie has over 30 years of plantation experience, having started his career in Kumpulan Guthrie Berhad in 1980 as an assistant manager. After earning his credentials through postings across Malaysia, he then was entrusted with Guthrie's Indonesian venture when he assumed the post of General Manager of Minamas Plantation in 2002. He subsequently became the CEO of Minamas Plantation in 2004 before becoming the CEO in 07. Dato' Frankie was appointed as Executive Vice President of Plantation Division, Saim Dabi, on November 2010, a position that oversees all of Saim Dabi Plantation upstream and downstream operations in 13 countries worldwide. Dato' Frankie is currently the Chairman of Malaysian Palm Oil Association. He's also a member of the Program Advisory Council and a member of the Malaysian Productivity Council. Ladies and gentlemen, I present to you Dato' Frankie Anthony Das. And our final member on the panel I'd like to introduce is Mr. Subramaniam R. Ramasamy, who is currently the president of Global Head of Plantation in Olam International Limited, in addition to being the chairman of Community of Practice for Tree Crop Plantations. He held several senior positions in his career spanning over 32 years in the plantation sector. Amongst others, he worked with Good Hope Asia Holdings Limited as Director Operations and Felder Global Ventures in Nambahud as Head of Plantations and Mills. His experiences in plantation management include crops like oil palm, rubber, cocoa, and processing facilities, having served in Malaysia, Indonesia, and Africa. Subramaniam holds a Bachelor of Science in Agriculture and a Master's in Plantation Management from Agricultural University of Malaysia. He pursued a management program at the Graduate School of Business in the University of Chicago. He's a member of the Incorporated Society of Planters, Malaysian Soil Science Society, and Malaysian Institute of Management. There you have it, ladies and gentlemen, our final panelists. Give a round of applause to Mr. Subramaniam R. Ramasamy. And with that, ladies and gentlemen, you know who our distinguished panel is. And of course, you know our Tan Sri. So with that, Tan Sri, I hand over the program to you.
Thank you, Iskandar. Hello and good evening. What we want to do for now, for the next maybe 30 to 50 minutes, is to conduct this CEO's forum. It is an ongoing series of CEO forum that we have started in the past. It went with in the past with our Pillar Dinner Award. We normally hold a kind of a CEO forum before the dinner award to get our leaders of the industry to provide some vision of their own as pertaining to issues of the oil palm industry. And so today this is being done in the same manner to get our so-called captains of the industry, the CEOs of various well-established companies, to state or at least share their views and perhaps their visions about what we should be doing in terms of addressing the theme of the POTS event this time, the challenges and opportunities, maximizing profits maybe. These are ongoing issues and always very important to hear our leaders how they look at the industry and look at these issues. So, but of course, in a forum, it's a two-way process. We will also invite submissions, written comments and written requests or views, as well as questions from the floor relating to the issues as well as relating to what the panelists would be presenting. So you are encouraged to do that. It is an interactive session. And so we anticipate your active participation by your submissions. I hope our people will be able to collect your submissions and pass it up here for us, for me later on to sort out and read out the ones relevant for the theme for the discussion today. So we must also take a little time now to reflect about the 2 days of presentations. We have put a fairly comprehensive program of presentations, 18 papers, as you know, and I think the presentation the authors of these presentations, they have been very, let's say, committed to bring about the best information for you, best set of ideas that you should trigger you to think a lot more about how we should address the issues and problems faced by our palm oil industry. So that being said, I would now move on to invite each of the panelists to say their so-called 5 minutes viewpoints and visions about how the palm oil industry challenges could be itemized, top five challenges maybe from their standpoint, or also top five profit maximizing opportunities that they would like to share with us, and perhaps some potential plan of actions that may need to be taken up either by the government or by trade associations or by all of us operating in the palm oil industry. So this obviously is a rather unplanned kind of intervention from them, offer of views. So I hope it works. We are trying out this experiment to see how much of ideas can we harvest from all of you, from the panelists, and it will be a fairly concluding end to our POTS seminar. So with that, again, may I just proceed to invite Tan Sri Leo Hian to start the ball rolling and use your 5 minutes. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Tan Sri Yusof. I think first of all, I'd like to again congratulate MPOC for organizing such a wonderful POTS in KL, well attended. I think we heard a lot about prices, but I think prices will be where they will be. But for plantations, I think one of the things that really concern us is our stagnating yields. We have seen how the American Soybean Association was, the American soybean industry this year, I think, having a record crop. And they are saying that their yields have gone up 10%, you know. I remember many years ago, some time ago, not too long ago, rather, not many years, sorry, that I used to remember this figure of 3.6 tons of soybean yield per hectare. That's a reasonably good figure. But this year, I reckon the U.S. is producing an average of 4.3 tons per hectare. It's alarming, you know. And when seminar after seminar, we hear our yields stagnating around 4 tons of oil per hectare. So I guess plantations who are not able, especially the organized plantations, who are not able to get to 6 tons, which all our scientists and the breeding material they tell us is possible, then I think we can be in a very difficult time, especially when prices collapse. So I think that's one of the problem. I think it can be done if we everything needs a lot of efforts. You got to know all the basic about agronomy, how to improve it, and there are a lot of technology now, GPS, all those things that tells you which part of your field are not up to standard, which are yielding lower, and all those things. So I think stagnating yield is one of the big challenge. I think the second challenge is, which I'm sure is common to all, is labor. First, the cost of labor. Because I think Indonesia has this mandatory wage increase. And labor in this region, the wages have to increase with time, you know. And if we are still, secondly, there's no magic bullet, so to speak, to increase our labor productivity overnight. So it's a little bit at a time, you know, but we have got to move very much on this labor productivity. The NKEA, the National Economic Area, is that they have organized a group on mechanization. I think that's a very, very good move. But labor productivity is certainly, we cannot be working on 1 to 8 hectares, 1 man to 8 hectares, whereas soybean and all the other annual crops, they are working on a ratio of 1 to 1,000 hectares, you know. So those type of ratios are not so much in our favor. We need to narrow it down. Maybe even 1 to 15 will be a very big, good improvement for us. I think the third area I'd like to touch on is generally the culture, you know. I think I'm of the old generation, and the old generation planters seems to think the younger generation are not as, maybe it's our feeling, but I think it's, they must learn to take ownership, you know, ownership of things, you know. And I think we live in a very relaxed culture in this country, in Malaysia. So I think we really need to tighten up our management and to really take ownership. And they need to think about, how do I create value in the job that I'm doing? How do I do things better? They need to really think, you know. I think it's, we are just too complacent. In terms of strategy for the industry, I think our ministry is doing quite a very good job in terms of the strategy. But I think we must also think of things like black swan. What happened when black swan events happen? What happened when, for example, some of the European countries changed their biodiesel mandate, and the palm oil consumption, edible oil consumption reduced by 5 million tons, you know. What are we going to do? Is the biodiesel consistently using B7? Does it make sense? I think it makes sense in a period, a low period, but in a period where the palm oil price is very low, okay? But when the palm oil price is above 3,000, maybe we should switch back to B3, you know, to conserve resources for periods when we need that. So these are the fine tuning of some of the strategic thinking that the ministry has to do. I think I'm asked to talk about five areas, but I think one of the opportunities is also technology. There's a lot of technology down there, and I feel that our plantation industry is not adopting it fast enough to increase productivity. Thank you, Tan Sri.
Thank you, Tan Sri. Please remember to jot down and submit your comments, questions, and even opinions that we can share during this forum. I move on now to invite Dato' Lee Yau Chor, please. Yeah.
I go here. Yeah. Thank you. Well, good evening, everybody. It's not often that I get the chance to wear this wireless mic, so I thought I want to imitate the American TV personality who try to speak not from the rostrum. So this is my rare chance. I'm glad to see that most of you, the hall is still quite full, in spite of the late hour, and in spite of this session coming after the Dorab mystery, who has always been touted as the star power of the seminars. So I think we still got some attraction here among us. Well, today I'm only going to talk about one challenge as the CEO of a plantation company. And that challenge is about dealing with NGOs and online media. I think many of you have already know about the challenge that IOI has been facing, maybe from April this year. So some publicities have been generated. And today, my purpose is to just share the experience. So it's important for the media, please take note. I'm sharing the experience. I'm not criticizing anybody, including the NGOs or the online media. Otherwise, I will have a lot of work to do tomorrow to answer the adverse publicity that will come my way. So so the purpose is to share the experience of the challenge faced by me as a CEO of IOI during the past few months. So indeed, it has been, of course, a very challenging period. So it all started from a suspension by RSPO. Decision was given in early April. And of course, even though the complaint by an NGO to RSPO was on a relatively small area of our Indonesian plantation, but of course the RSPO decided to actually suspend the certification for the whole group. That means it's not just the plantation, but also our downstream operations globally. And downstream operations, of course, operates under very different rules as compared to the plantation. But nevertheless, decision was made to suspend certification for the whole group. So my first point about this is that when dealing with NGOs and even some, I would say, non-mainstream media, actually, we are not dealing with normal commercial people whom we are very familiar with. I think most of you are business people. So the line of thinking is very different. It's very different. So for example, if you feel that decision is not right, normally as a business people, we go to the court to challenge it. Of course, it doesn't help that I'm also a lawyer by training, but that, of course, is the natural thing that we want to do, that we do, and everything's very professional. If you go to a court and the decision is made one way, we abide by it. But, however, I think we learned that in the world of NGOs and online media, the thinking is very different. So, for example, in the case when the challenge is, a legal challenge is made, then the attacks or the comments, I wouldn't say attack, the comments from the NGOs is that, oh, because you mount a challenge in court, that means you are not serious in trying to correct your sustainability activities. Of course, that's not true, because there are two different matters. But that's the line of thinking that we have to face. And as a result, a lot of adverse publicity was generated just because we wanted to put our case in the court. Anyway, these are history. And of course, after that, after a lot of work on the ground, we managed to lift the suspension of the certification. So RSPO convinced, after a process, are convinced that improvements have been made. In fact, improvements have been made since, I would say, many years ago, 2 to 6 years ago, because those were related. The complaint earlier was on events that happened 2 to 6 years ago. Of course, since then, we have improved. But then, nevertheless, the decision came very late. So another point that I would like to say is that, of course, IOI, we have been in the plantation industry for quite some time. So we think we can manage plantations fairly well. Following agronomic practice, etc., is no problem. But then today, we find that is not enough. That is not enough. So now, I have to be besides a plantation specialist, I have to be a communication specialist. And really, it is a very, very new area for a plantation company like this. Nevertheless, it's a whole new thing, whole new world of organizations we have to deal with. Even online media. Of course, the traditional media, we know who they are. The Star, Straits Times, Xinjiu, we know who they are. But online media, they come in all shapes and sizes. Some have got specific agenda, some which is environment, some are just business online media. And there are some are very, I would say, very partisan in their outlook. So we have to know who we are dealing with. Because if we speak to the wrong media, actually, or we respond to the wrong media, to the media that it has got very, I would say, hidden agenda, then the whole thing gets blown again out of proportion. So then we have to learn how to choose the right words. Of course, being a lawyer, I think I know how to choose the right words, but again, in this new world of accessibility, so the languages used are, again, different, very different. And of course, more technical things that we need to get familiar with. Actually, and of course, lastly, because we are dealing with online media and some Western-based NGOs, the communication has to be round the clock. So I have to coordinate with my colleagues in Europe, in America, to make sure that we are having a consistent message. And then, of course, we have to give our response very quickly. So practically, I have many late nights. I wouldn't say sleepless nights. I have many late nights. So another issue that arises from this challenge is suddenly you find that there are many consultants springing up. So you have even specialists, forest specialists. There are different types. Peat specialists also you know, different types. Some are on the ground. Some are more on planning, more on about how to do a plan or landscape approach and then we have, of course, the on the ground specialists and communication specialists. Again, communication specialists, also there are different types. Some specialize in stakeholders engagement, others specialize in media engagement. It's different, huh? So a lot of consultants that you can engage if you listen to all the proposals. So again, we have to be very perceptive. Lastly is the, of course, in the middle of all that, we have our operational staff, the operational people in the estates who have to comply with all these very stringent demands from or even some, I would say, sometimes fanciful suggestions from people who have not stepped into the plantations. So, or very little. So, imagine people on the ground who have been in the plantations all their life, having to listen to suggestions from 20-something or 30 years old who might just visit palm oil plantations once or twice in their life. But they have to listen to what is said or try to follow what is said. But of course, these people on the outside are not there when a fire during the El Nino comes in. During the El Nino, when a wildfire starts, try putting out the fire. You can't even get near the fire within 200 meters, let alone trying to fight the fire or put out the fire. So it is very important that the view of the people on the ground has to be listened to and respected. And then, of course, for plantation people, because they, again, now the approach of a lot of the consultants and NGOs are, you must have this management plan, you must have this strategy, action plan, 1, 2, 3. So theoretically, you can have 20 plans on all sorts of areas, on forest, on peat, on fire, etc. So you can have 20 plans. But the plantation people, we are action-oriented. We don't keep on reading the plans. And it's very difficult for plantation people to go and draw out plans. Because by the time they write it out in plans, the work is would have already been done. Yeah? God, for them, is go out in the field and get it done faster that way, instead of writing out the plan and then trying to follow the plan. So these are just sharing some of the issues that more the personal experience of that I've gone through in the last few months. And lastly, I would say that for us, IOI, we still believe in openness and engagement with all parties, including all NGOs and I would say the media. And so we have been responsive, and I think that is important. But of course, what's important is that, of course, there's the pressure. There will be a lot of pressure from NGOs on our customers, who were, of course, threatened to suspend relationship with us. So it's easy for us to compromise, because customers is the king. We have to listen to the customers who have been pressured by the NGOs. So it's easy to just compromise and give in, okay, follow what the NGOs want or what the customers want through them. However, I believe that as a responsible plantation company CEO, we must think of the long-term business viability of the business. We should not just think about short-term compromise just so that business can run easily on the short term. So the long-term business viability, the fairness to our business associates, including our suppliers, because pressure are also being put onto our suppliers, but we have to be fair to our business associates. And lastly, we also have to think that we have to support the country's economic agenda, the government's national development agenda of developing palm oil as an industry to boost up the economy. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dato Lee Yau Cho. We want to move on to invite Dato Frankie. Your presentation now, please.
Thank you, Tan Sri. Sitting with all this mic here, those who do not know us, they'll think it's Chinese and Indian Secret Service. Next year, we are a 100-year-old industry. The plantation industry reaches a milestone. We have gone through the El Nino. I'm touching two main challenges here. We have gone through many El Ninos and weather conditions, and we see the vagaries of the commodity prices. And yet, after 100 years, we still have not found a solution to manage this. And we have got, so business simply cannot be as usual now. We know, and last year, undoubtedly, was one of the toughest years. First off, we had the El Nino hitting us with our production. And in the second half, the price went down. Now, how do we survive during this period? Because the shareholders continue to expect the returns. And here we got to manage our cost to keep it low. And that is not also easy. I think the plantation biting point is around 1,400 ringgit or so, plus minus. And if the price comes down anything below 2,000, we are very close to making only a very marginal profit. And now if we look at the extremes of the weather condition, the dry period comes in. We have to now change the way we manage our water management, even looking at even irrigation or any other form of enhancing or minimizing the impact on our production. That fundamentally is a very key impact for the plantation companies. You can put in the best materials, replant, but the weather comes in and just wipes out your production, anything even 30, even 40%. So the way we now need to manage the agro-management aspects on the field has to change. Water management, process also changes. You now need to really appreciate every bit of water that is there and how you conserve and you bring it to the pumps. That is done, and I think a lot of companies are already moving. Sime Dabi is already moving into that way. And then now you look at the vagaries of the prices again. And it's frustrating every time you find that the price, in a way, well, we can't do anything much about it. But then there is this competition even with Indonesia. So through SIPOP, we should harmonize both Malaysia and Indonesia along the taxes, levies, tariff, and sustainability credentials, so that if both these countries start competing, the winners are actually the buyers, and we are going to lose out. So unless it's standardized, we have a level playing field for both these countries. Being 85% of the world's production, and here we do not even harmonize that. And I think that is process has started through SIPOP, and we hope to see some good things coming out of that. And you move on further on, I think Dato' Lee touched on it just now, is the constant demands on the sustainable palm oil. You have done RSPO certification, it's not enough, because the NGOs or the green NGOs or social NGOs, human rights, and many other groups continue to focus. The attack on palm oil only gets intense. So how then do a company now position yourself? Again, business cannot be as usual. You got to now change your strategy. Dato' Lee touched on it. The communication strategy, the way we position ourselves. This is a time, I would say, Malaysia can position itself, brand its oil, as the Malaysian brand of sustainable palm oil, or the preferred global supplier of palm oil comes from Malaysia. The big boys are already RSPO certified. Now, we have the Malaysian Palm Oil Certification Council. They can accelerate and help out to certify the smaller companies and the smallholders. That way, with the next 100 years, Tan Sri, we can go out, the PM can declare and say, Malaysia will be 100% sustainable palm oil. And with that, this is something we can do as well. Drop the crude from the CPO and call it palm oil or green palm oil. And that way people know this is coming from the best source, it's coming from Malaysia, it's a Malaysian brand. And that's the CPO that we want to produce. And the NGOs will continue to demand other things to us. These are all added costs. You find a lot of alliance, various forums are being started, and of course plantation companies as growers, we participate. But the guys who actually started doing work on the ground will be the growers, and this adds to the cost. And every other thing that you do adds to the cost. And you come back now to the Malaysian government itself, where they should pay more attention to this plantation industry, provide better incentives, even increase the budget for the industry. You find sometime in a way our industry is not getting that much of prominence. And look at we are labor intensive, while we need to mechanize and automate and move to digital technology to enhance the productivity or operational efficiencies and even the performance management. But labor is still required. And every time there's an issue with the labor recruitment or approval, it always stymies, gets delayed, and this has an impact. And in fact, all these delays eventually goes back to the bottom line, not only to the company, but also to the country's revenue. We contribute something like 60, 70 billion to the GDP, and including rubber, there's another 15 to 18 billion. And this is an industry the government will pay a lot of attention to, provide it, make it more competitive. And including the smallholders, during the low CPO price, they are the ones who are going to suffer as well. And here again, the labor, they can make it easier in terms of the extension of period for workers that are brought in. The levies can be reduced. We don't have to pay. It causes you extremely expensive to bring workers and to move on. But like us, what we do now, we have mechanized. We move into a lot of mechanization, automation. That can probably reduce 30-40% of your labor as we move up our ratio per hectare. But the labor is still required. And that's another very key challenge. And you move further down. While we have the green products, whether we sell it as a commodity or a specialty or a differentiated product, and there's a lot of opportunity here as well, that we move to premium oil differentiated product, capture that market. And Malaysia as a brand should move into that. And this is another way during low commodity prices probably will help us to mitigate and enhance our profitability. And the other challenge that I find now, the younger people or the Gen Y or the Gen Z is the zombies, eh? They don't want to come and work in the plantation. How do you get them to come? What do you find? The other veterans are still running. A lot of companies still keep them until they drop dead. Then the younger ones, we need to get the best of them to come and work in the plantations, attract them. And we can't do again the way we did for the last 100 years. Things has to change. How do we get these young people to come in, stay with us longer? Because if this company or the plantations have been there for 100 years, I know it will be there for another 100 years. And for that, we need those good people. That is a challenge now. We need to go out and attract this, the best brains from the universities. The workers that we are getting now need to be trained. We need to automate, mechanize, make it more attractive to them. Until today, we have done some level of mechanization, but we have been unsuccessful in cutting or harvesting the crop. And this is where a concerted effort actually has to be done. But if you look at our industry, we have the MPOA, which represents the growers, another very long-serving association. We have the MPOB, which has done the science and the technicality to promote the palm oil. They've done a fantastic job. We have the MPOC again promoting and marketing the palm oil. We have the ISP, the PORAM, the NASH. How do we then now have to put all these to work collectively to enhance the industry as a whole? I think one cannot be working in silo, just relying on MPOC to do the job. The negativity on palm oil. Today, I can tell you, there were those days the only ambassador the oil palm industry had was the late Tun Lim Keng Yek. Today, the only ambassador left is Tun Tan Sri Basiron Yusof. And I think we need a lot more ambassadors. We need to enhance in this. How else can we take the plantation industry to the next level? The business as usual over the last 100 years is over. The challenges, as I see it, the same challenges continue to be there. It's only getting more intense. And we need to find answers to many things. Some we have got the answers, but others none. But having said that, research will play a very critical part to come out with better, superior planting materials that will give us higher yields, disease tolerant, drought tolerant. We need to look at innovation. The innovative culture in the plantation is not existing that strongly. The innovative ways of doing things to go into the next phase. And sustainability. You cannot run away from this. Today they look at us in these areas. I think if we are able to position ourselves in this arena, it will be very, very critical for the plantation and especially for companies even like us. For Sime Darby in 13 countries, the standardization, training of people, harmonizing and ensuring the consistency is applied across anywhere we operate. You just can't afford to make a mistake. What Dato' Lee is telling about IOI's issue, it can just happen to Sime Darby today or to Olam or KLK or any other companies. Are we prepared to handle that? Because they're not going to forgive you or they will look for something. Even in a supply chain, somebody else makes a mistake. The plantation or the company itself has to answer for it. These are very critical challenges to the industry. And we have to be thankful that we have, without any doubt, for Malaysia. And if you look at the palm oil itself, I think it's Malaysia single-handedly has done all that in terms of developing the plantations, the MPOB, which has done tremendous job, and even MPOC promoting. And that can't go along too long. You've got to get Indonesia in the forefront to work with us. These days, running plantation companies, it can be sleepless. When you finish with the extremes of weather condition, then comes the price issue. Then comes the haze issue. Anything goes wrong, it is so easy to blame the palm oil industry. And we have while we go around promoting the palm oil, we have here locally in the country, international schools, teachers telling and demonizing the palm oil to our own very people, the younger people in this country. So the challenge is even in our own country. So the challenges are many, and I think if you read, I've already mentioned those five challenges. What more? What more about disruptive technology, the GMO, oil seeds, and the other edible oil, which are going to be a stiff competition to us, because they, for a new material development in plantation, takes easily 10, 15 years. That's how the gestation period is. Well, they can do it much faster with the other oil seeds. And these are very serious challenges to the industry. And for plantation companies like us, it is always keeping us awake, yes, late at night, and then you still have to answer, and answer to the board and shareholders. And also telling, these days the board shareholders want to know what else we are doing differently to manage these challenges. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dato' Frankie. I hope you are getting a sense of how visionary the leaders are in terms of addressing the challenges faced by the industry, and hopefully you will also respond. Quickly, we move on to invite Mr. Subramaniam, your take on this.
Thank you, Tansri. Thank you, Potts, for inviting Olam and myself. I'm going to tweak this discussion a little bit. After hearing all the challenges from my colleagues on the stage, I think I'll talk a little bit about one or two sweet things about the industry and about Africa. I'll focus a little bit on Africa and one or two challenges what we face in Africa. So I think that will make it a more balanced discussion other than all the challenges. And then we'll have a sleepless night tonight too. So in Africa, today the production is about 2.2 million tons average, and demand is about 5 million. There's a deficit of 3.5, 3.8 million. And this deficit is only going to widen. One or two reasons, I'll just briefly touch on that. One is population growth in Africa. Today is 1.2 million, 2050 is expected to be 2.4 billion, and out of that, 48% are going to be below 18 years, the demographic. The GDP of the middle income group is really increasing. Today, those who are earning more than $3,000 is in the region of 100 million people above. So the purchasing power. So we believe that demand drivers, the key demand drivers are the population growth. And on the whole, on the some of the calculations which I personally made is that for every billion increase of population in the world, we will need about 24 million tons of edible oil, let it be palm oil, vegetable oil, or a mix. So there's a huge demand growth there. The other thing is that some of our success in Africa, as I said, I like to talk about one or two sweet things, is I think looking at Africa the way it's growing. Look at the countries which are democratically elected in Africa over the last 10 to 15 years. There were 54 sovereign states, but now today there are about 30 democratically elected governments. And these governments understand the need for agriculture to feed the people. And there's so much of this Marshall Plan, agricultural Marshall Plan, which are coming up. Countries like in Gabon, where we operate, our flagship development is, countries like Ethiopia, Tanzania. And I think we should take some advantage of this to invest in these countries.
Okay, Mr. Subramaniam, we are somewhat fighting for time, maybe two or three summarized points.
Yeah,
we opened it up.
Thanks, Sanjay. So, one of the key things is that I think the good success factor is the good public-private partnership, which is very important, equity participation of the government. And on the other hand, some of the challenges we face would be on the infrastructure developments in these countries where we develop. It is still a developing country, so infrastructure can be challenging. So, that's a cost to that. So that is one of the challenges which face, which countries like Malaysia and Indonesia have overcome. The other thing is sustainability. Since we are talking about sustainability and the challenges we are facing, Africa also faces the sustainability issues. But since we are starting from inception, these sustainability issues we can take the driver's seat and not sustainability taking the driver's seat. So we'll be able to take charge of sustainability and put in all the places what we have. So these are some of the challenges we have in Africa. Since there's a time constraint, I'd like to pass over to Tan Sri.
Thank you. I just want to be fair and give opportunity for the floor to respond, for you to respond from the floor. If there is any written comments that you wish to submit, I hope my rapporteurs will be around. Otherwise, if you want to make one or two interventions using the microphones, please do so. Anybody wanting to add to what the, or even ask the panelists, anyone? We have 10 minutes before this clock will stop. Anybody at all? Yes, this side, this side. Yeah, please, Martin. Is that Martin?
Yeah, Martin.
Hello. Touching on what Dr. Frankie said and perhaps Dr. Lee, we heard this afternoon Dorab Mistry beg us to remove export tax, saying that it was killing the viability of our industry. I just wondered how you would respond to that. Thank you.
That's it. Me? Well, we ask you.
Okay. Export tax of CPO.
I think this again, when the tax is set, the export tax, as I said, the requirement is to harmonize that with Indonesia. We put that set a tax here, and Indonesia sets another different tax. And if we need to harmonize both these countries, the tax, if it's required by the government, even that has to be very well planned, how to strategically put it. Then again, you see India, which is a price sensitive. I think he said just now, to protect our refiners, we put a tax here, and if it's olein is coming into landed into India, it's as good as price is as cheap as CPO. Then the bigger profits to the upstream is lost there. I think these are the kind of consideration the government needs to rethink back. And the representation and submission to this is very important. We have a new minister on this, and I'm sure Tan Sri and the industry captains will bring forth some suggestions how to best handle this export tax.
It's work in progress, to put it okay. Shortly. Yes, Dr. Lee.
Oh, yeah. I think everything has to be in balance. So we have to recognize that when palm oil price is high, then margins do get squeezed, generally speaking, for refineries. So for my personal opinion is that when palm oil price is high, then some help should be given to the refineries by having the export duty on CPO. Because, of course, Dorab mentioned the point that the value add for refinery is limited. But then, if you don't have a refinery base, you can't go on to specialty fats or oleochemical downstream as what he has suggested. So refinery will still be needed as a base. However, we should not put in the export duty when palm oil price is, CPO is already low, because that will be, of course, be adding additional burden on to CPO producers. So we need to have a flexible strategy always, because in some countries, of course, where refineries are already there, they will put in their export duty regime. For example, India, there's a differential between CPO and refined oil. So they will protect their industry already. But there will be some countries where refinery industry are not yet mature. And so that's when our refined oil can go in instead of the CPO. And for India, maybe then CPO, more CPO. So it's all, we have to be flexible and not have a one-directional policy, in my view.
Tan Sri, may I? Also, there's another one, the windfall tax. For Malaysia Peninsula is 2,005 and East Malaysia is 3,000. Now with the costs of production going up, maybe the windfall tax threshold should also be changed. Standardize it and keep it at 3,000. I think RM 3,000 is real windfall, not 2,005. at this. Something to consider, Tansri.
Yes, thank you very much. Maybe we just have time for one or two interventions from the floor. If you have any, please, show of hands. I'll try and accommodate your... Yes, please, on this side.
I have a question for Mr. Subramaniam. I understand that the consumption per capita, oils and fats in Africa is very low, very much lower than India, which is currently about 18 kg per capita. But when do you think that Africa will attain that kind of level?
Thank you. I think the consumption today in Africa as a whole is about 9.4 kilos. And when you take the global things, about 24 kilos, 22 kilos, 25 kilos. So I think the demand today, as I said, deficit is about 3.4 million. And to achieve that, you will need another 5 million. So that will be about 9 million. So you will need another 1.2 million, 1.3 million hectares planting. So maybe in the year of 2050, it's a long way. It's a long way, I can tell you that. It's a long way.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, unless there's a burning request, there's one here anymore. I hope that will be the last because we are trying to round up everything. Yes, have the microphone and...
All right, this will be a fun question for everyone on stage. If you could choose only one word to describe the organization that you're leading, what would you choose and why?
Put that in again, choose an...
If you had to choose one word to describe the organization that you are leading, what word would you choose?
Your own organization that you are leading.
Yeah, it's non-business, but I hope it could close the entire thing.
Well, let's try them. Maybe they will.
Okay, I think that's a
tough one. How do you describe one word of KLK or IOI or Climb Derby?
I think there are many words, but one word maybe you can choose is aspirational.
For me, it's progressive.
The biggest inspirational company, actually, Sime Davi.
lawyer guy.
Olam, for us to stay in this business, I think it's differentiated.
Okay, you heard that. Thank you very much. This is the last comment coming from the floor. I don't want to look for an elaborate answer, but I still want to respect the effort made. So I'll read out the comments or even the questions, seeking comments from the panelists. Given the growing number of denigrating campaigns against palm oil in Europe and the no palm oil labels used by many competitors, what strategy should we follow to counter these practices? Anyone wanting to elaborate on what the government or industry can do, or even MPOC can do? Before that, I must declare that they are my current chairman, the boss, and the former boss chairman, and board member sitting here, so I'm just passing everything back to them. Okay, good. Anyone?
I'll try to start first. I think, first of all, this is a very long-haul problem. Yeah. So I think we need to have a lot of sustained policy and a sustained energy in strategy. Eventually, I think we have to change mindset. You know, go to the country, work with key people in particular countries, and see how we can influence the people there based on science and based on logic. You know, I know Tansri also talk is always based on logic, you know, productivity of palm, the health issue of palm, and all, either science or logic. I think these are our foundation. Yeah. So I think we have to keep on with those policies.
Okay, I just add a few points. So I think we need to be innovative in our approach of reaching the consumers in those countries. Don't forget, a lot of them are the strong opinionated one are the younger consumers, because the older one will be what we normally call will term as the silent majority or the moderate majority. But it's the younger ones who are very loud and vocal. And we need to reach them through innovative methods or campaigns. And that's why MPOC has instituted the branding campaign last year in France and Belgium. And then the next thing is feel that to really overcome that perception, which is very strong, we will need allies or friends of palm oil. So, and this, of course, the best one comes from the countries itself where the anti-palm oil campaign happens. So we have allies. We build up allies in France, in Italy, in Netherlands to help fight the case. And that's not all. That's not enough. And then we have to have allies as well from other palm oil producing countries, such as, of course, Indonesia and Africa. And Africa, of course, they have palm oil producers, and always when people perceive African palm oil producers, the perception, at least in Europe, is that they are poor and small. And so they should not be bullied all the time or be beaten down all the time. They should be given space to grow. And so we use allies like this, and then together we can then overcome this sometimes unfair and negative image against palm oil.
I've partially answered the question earlier. To create that Malaysian brand, by 2020, we can get the entire Malaysian palm oil as certified, sustainable, traceable, out there to the world, and I think that will already create that impression. Malaysia can take the lead there and do it further. As I said, MPOCC can do the certification, accelerate for the small holders. Everyone in the industry, the growers, this is a time to position. The other one is to reach out to the younger generation there, the social media, making them understand. Yesterday I met some trainees here, management trainees in our country, and they were telling me, I said, do you have any subjects on palm oil in your syllabus, curriculum so far? They said nothing. They have not read anything. And how then we want to convince our European counterparts, when even in our own country? So I think this literature is required, hotels, something. This is a national crop actually. There should be good benefits of palm oil written up, placed in hotels, even a syllabus in schools here. So that, as I said, Tan Sri Yusof Basron cannot be the ambassador alone. We have to create more ambassadors. The communication strategy has to be enhanced. We are not going around destroying forests. We have 60% of forests. And if you look at it, not many people know that oil palm occupies only 0.31% of the total agricultural land and 4.5% of the 250 million vegetable oil land. And when you tell this to the Europeans, a lot of them can't believe that is that area, and yet it produces 36% to 40% of the vegetable oil. These are very significant statistics. This needs to be broadcasted, publicized, and made it known. Thank you.
I believe in, I think in the continuous engagement with all the stakeholders, and I think that's very, very important. Sometimes we shy away. I think we should not shy away. As I said earlier, we should take the driving seat of sustainability and not sustainability take the driving seat. So continuous engagement is very important. Thank you.
So if I may, I think we are ending the program. We have about 2.5 minutes to go on this clock. Oh. There is closing remarks coming from me, and I'm going to do it now. So first of all, thank you for staying up to now and participating and listening, especially hoping that you take good notes of what the so-called CEOs of our top industry plantation companies have already offered to share with you. These are good visionary opinions and views that I hope will add to the value of our POTS seminar for the last 2 days. And talking about our POTS events, with that theme already elaborated by our panelists, as well as the 18 papers presented by our presenters, I'm sure you have noticed the improve quality as well as information that have been packaged into the 2 days of seminar presentations. And I think the authors, the presenters, especially the three prize gurus, we must keep appreciating their effort, commitment to join us, although they are very busy, but all three of them turn up, and we are no less in terms of presentation quality compared to other similar price forecasting seminars, because we benefited from their views and projections, price forecasts, as always from Dorab, the most entertaining way. So I hope you will continue to support our activity, our event, not only MPOC, but how we want to continue to address challenges and look at opportunities where we feel that the participation as well as support and active involvement of industry as stakeholders to protect, to progress the industry, especially having heard about what has happened for the last 100 years to the next 100 years. I think we feel that this industry is very well organized and it should continue to be well organized to progress forward for the next 100 years. I wouldn't want to elaborate on what we should do and all that because you have heard all the challenges and opportunities through the two-day seminar, the workshop sessions and all that. We wanted to sell more palm oil, of course. That is the main objective of this seminar. But we have to work hard to get it done. So with that, I want to thank all of you, those who have left as well, for your participation, for your support, and of course the panelists for their commitment to share their views with you. And also the sponsors, I must say we got good sponsors, and we are making this participation at our POTS event very affordable, but very value-packed, if you like, for that price. So with that, we have a very good screen, as you can see. It's all LCD digitalized screen with a very good picture of Kuala Lumpur. And that would hopefully bring good memories, or you take home good memories with you and have a safe journey back. Thank you very much.